Hello, it's Keith here, and welcome to the Hello World series. This time we're going to be looking at the Super Nintendo, aka the Super Famicom. Now, of course, these are very popular systems. They're 16-bit systems, or at least by most people's definitions. Very powerful systems, but they are a little bit tricky to get working as a beginner. So we're going to be looking at a relatively minimal version of some code that will just get a Hello World message onto the screen using the tilemap, and hopefully that'll help you get started if you just really want to do the basics on this system. So let's go over and have a look at our code. So here's the code. Now, first thing to point out is I'm using the processor as a 6502. The processor is a 65816, but it's a backward compatible system. We're just using 6502 code with a 6502 assembler, and for basics, that's going to be enough. Grime 6502 was fairly playable, and it never used a single 16-bit command. We're going to be looking at 16-bit next year, though, in the 65816 series, so bear with me on the 16-bit stuff. We're going to stick to 8-bit for now as a beginner. Okay, well, first of all, let's just prove I can actually deliver the goods. Let's see the code running today. And there we go. So we've got a nice Hello World here. We've got it twice, a double bonus there. So you can see here, we can get a Hello World on screen. And this is the tilemap doing the work here. Let's get out of the way. And let's have a look at our code today. Now, our ROM files don't have a header as such, but they do have a footer. And this is what defines the cartridge and the hardware that it has and the requirements. Now, we can keep all of this pretty much the same as is. The important bit is going to be at the bottom here. We've got the reset vector, which is the start of the program code. Now, you can see there's a 6502 and a 65816 section here. It's the 6502 section that this code's going to be running because we're in 6502 mode. Now, as I've said before, you don't really need to change this kind of code. It's going to work fine as is, so we're not really going to cover that header in any real detail today. So here's the start of our ROM here, a memory address hexadecimal 8000. We're turning off the interrupts, and then we're going to start defining our screen. So the first thing we're doing here is we're defining the addresses of our background, and we're having to define the VRAM location here. These are just some generic settings that we've got to set up to get anything working. Now, don't worry too much about them at this stage. It's just we need some settings to get everything set up and working. And what we're doing here is we're disabling the screen. Why are we disabling the screen? Well, we need to actually set up our fonts in the tile memory first, and it's going to be easier if the screen's turned off because we can't write to video memory with the screen drawing. We can write in VBank or we can write when the screen's off. Well, let's just turn the screen off and make things easy for us. Next, we're going to set up the colors here. So to do this, we're using register 2121. And this will select the color number we want to change. So color 0, we're using STZ, which is a 65CO2 special command. It's not a 6502 command as such. And that stores a 0 to memory address. So we're defining the background as blue here, a kind of darkish blue. You can see there's 5 bits per channel here. And then we're defining color 15, and we're defining it as yellow. I always use the top color on the system for the color of the font, and the Super Nintendo is a 16 color system for the tiles. So that's what we're doing here. We're defining color 15 and color 0 here. And we're using 2121 to select the color, and then 2 writes to 2122 for the new palette entry for that color. Now what we want to do is we want to actually store our font in memory. We're defining how the memory addresses increment just here with this setting. And then we're loading the address of the pattern data in with 2116 and 2117. And we're loading to memory address 1000 in hexadecimal here. Here's the address of our bitmap font. You can see the font just down here. This font has 96 characters, the first one being space, character 32, and it's 1 bit per pixel, a black and white font. We're going to convert that so that it's color 0 or color 15 here. And what we're going to do is we're going to process each of the lines of the font, all 768 lines, and we're going to set all of the bit planes, 4 bit planes, to either 0 or 1. And if you don't know what bit planes are, a 16 color system will use 4 bits per pixel. And rather than storing all those 4 bits together, it's storing all of the bits for 8 pixels in one section. So you will have 8 pixels of bit 0, 8 pixels of bit 1, 8 pixels of bit 2, and 8 pixels of bit 3. I know that's a bit weird, it might not be the best explanation, but don't worry about it too much at this stage. There is some more tutorials on this in my platform specific series already, and it's not something you probably need to worry about too much at this stage anyway. So that's the theory of the bit planes, But what we're doing here is we're executing this do-bit-plane function. Let's have a look at that now. So the layout of the system is a bit weird on the Super Nintendo. There's two bit planes clustered together here, bit plane 0 and 1, and two here, 1 and 2. So we're doing two pairs at a time with this function. We're reading in a line from our font, and we're writing that line to two of the bit planes, incrementing our counters, repeating 8 times, and then returning. So we do bit plane 0 and 1 here, and 2 and 3 here. Then we check what our Y position is, and if we've completed the low byte, which was being counted by Y, we then increment the counter for the top byte of our memory address for the bitmap font, and then we decrease the X counter, which is the top byte just here. So that loop will set up our font. We now need to set up our scroll position. We're doing that with these values just here. We're doing the X and the Y position here, so that sets the screen up in a nice logical way. We're then clearing the screen because the emulator I'm using at the moment will actually load garbage into all of the RAM just to give us a really hard time. So we are just clearing the tilemap here, basically writing zeros with this SDZ command to all entries in the tilemap. The tilemap as we've set it up is 32 by 32, nice small tilemap. And we're then zeroing the X and Y cursor. These are defined as pointers to zero page entries 40 and 41 here. Okay. So at this point, we're finally ready to actually start doing some work in our program. Now, from the point of view of my code, I'm using a print char routine just here. So what we're going to do is we're going to calculate an address within the tilemap and then change that address to show the pattern that relates to the character that the user wants to show. And that character is going to be in the accumulator. Because our font has no characters below space, which is character 32, we're subtracting character 32. You can see that just here. And then what we're doing is we're calculating the address of the tile we want to change. And here's our formula just here. Now, the tile map itself starts at 0 in VRAM. And the Y position is multiplied by 32 because there's 32 tiles in the tile map on each line. And then the X position is just added to that. Now, actually, each memory address stores 2 bytes. So it's a word per tile. But because each address stores 2 words, we don't need to multiply the X position by 2 or the Y position by 64. That's all we need to do. Now, to effect the multiplication, we're doing a set of bit shifts here. You can see we're effectively rotating to the right 3 times, and that's simulating a multiplication here because the 6502 doesn't have any multiply commands. We're then adding the X position here, and this has effectively calculated the new memory address just here in the accumulator and in hexadecimal 21 in the zero page. We now need to make sure we're in vblank, and so we're using this wait vblank function just here. Now, we didn't do this before, but now that the screen is turned on, whenever we write to VRAM, we've got to make sure we're in vblank, and that's what we're doing here. So we're reading in from memory address 4212, and we're testing the top bit, and if the top bit is 0, then we are not in vblank, and we just keep looping until we are, and when we are, we return. You'll notice we're backing up the accumulator just so that's unaffected. Of course, it's quite important because we're relying on the accumulator being the same here. So we then store the accumulator to 2116, and that will be the low byte of the memory address, and then we load in the 21 we calculated, which will be the high byte here, and we've now selected the VRAM address we want to write to. So we need to now set the new tile value for that memory address because we've calculated the tile address. We now need to set it. So the top byte in our case is always going to be 0. We're only using the first 255, or in fact the first 96 tiles within the pattern data. And also we don't need to set it to different palettes or do any flipping or anything. So the top byte is always 0. The bottom byte is the tile number we want to set, which is in the accumulator at this point. Once we've done that, we just need to increment our X counter, check if we've got to the end of the screen, tile 32, and if we have, we're using a new line command. And the new line command is just here. We zero the X position with that SDZ special command, increment the Y position, and then return. Now, that's just printing a single character, but within my tutorials, I always extend this into a print string routine. It's very simple. All it does is it uses zero page entries 20 and 21 as an address for a string. And it checks if it's reached a 255, and until it does, it prints the characters to the screen. When it finds one, it returns. So I use character 255 terminated strings, which I know is a little odd, but that's the way it is. So you can see we're loading in the Hello World string here, and we're printing it to the screen. We're doing a new line after each time. and that gave us the result we saw just here. So a bit of a pain, but not too bad. Super Nintendo is slightly easier than the NES, because with the NES the V-blank routine isn't as advanced, but it's still pretty easy. There is a more advanced way of doing things, which is using a buffer with VRAM. You would update it during V-blank in an interrupt handler. I've covered that in the platform specific series. I'm not going to cover it here, it's too complex for to be appropriate at this stage. But yeah, please take a look at that if you want to see more. Now, that's just getting Hello World to the screen. Whenever I do these tutorials, I always extend my Hello World example to do a little bit more. And what I do is I try and get some basic monitoring tools. This includes a memory dump and a register dump. And you can see here, we just need to include these options here. And also this one here. But this is basically the same example, just with those extra tools. And where are they? Here they are. We've got the monitor, which will show the registers, and the mem dump, which will dump some lines of the memory. So let's fire this up and see it in action. And here we go. So we've got the accumulator, the X register, the Y register, the stack, the flags, and the program counter here. And we've dumped an area of memory which had absolutely nothing in it. Slightly disappointing. Anyway though, you can see there, we've got some simple tools to help us out if things aren't working as we expect and we just need to see what's really going on. Is our memory corrupted? Is our registers storing the values we think they are? Well, this way we can check it out. So that's something that maybe will help you if you're getting started. So we've seen a bog basic example, and we've seen some simple tools to help you out getting started. But what we haven't covered yet, and what is very, very important, is how do we actually build the cartridge? Because this is just source code. Well, let's take a look at that now. Now, of course, all of my tutorial code, all the sample files, all the attached source files, all the program code I use, the programs I've written are all free and open source, and the programs I use are all free and usually open source as well. So you can download them all from my website. But if you want to write your own scripts, of course, you totally should do. And I'm going to show you my script, so you can use that as a sort of template if you want. So I use Vasm for my assembly. It's only a 6502 assembler. It can't do the 16-bit 65816. We'll be using a different assembler in my tutorials next year on that. But it's great for 6502. So here we're specifying the source file. This is the ASM file, helloworld.asm or whatever. So that's where we're specifying that. I'm specifying a switch CO2 here. This specifies we want to be able to use the 65CO2 added commands that the 65816 supports, the SDZ for example. I'm specifying to check labels. This is a handy thing in Vasm. If you forget to put a tab on your commands, they will look like labels to the assembler, so your return command may be treated as a label and you'll get a crash, and this will warn you that you're about to get a crash, so save you a lot of debugging time. We're disabling case sensitivity because I'm not used to case sensitivity. I know I probably should be, but I'm not, and I only have limited time for debugging, so where possible I try and turn it off. The Vasm symbol, you probably don't need this. I define a symbol of the name of the assembler I'm using just in case I have to start supporting multiple assemblers later, but I currently don't need that. I'm outputting a listing file. These are quite handy if you're having trouble re-debugging or you're really wanting to dig into your processor. These will output the source lines and the bytecode that come out of it. If things are going wrong, sometimes maybe your code has confused the assembler and your labels, the addresses, are getting messed up. This can sometimes save you with that kind of thing, but hopefully if you're getting started you won't need to worry about it yet, because you probably won't understand what you're seeing if you're looking at the listing file. So as I say, it's something that's nice to have, but it's not the most essential thing in the early stages. Build SNS. This will relate to my monitor tools, may need it. A lot of my code is multi-platform, and I have conditional statements that will compile only on certain systems, so that's why I define that. Finally, I'm defining to output a binary file and specifying the output file as cart.sfc. Once we've built, assuming there were no errors, that's what that does, checks no errors, we're just firing up our assembler. I'm currently using Mesin, which is a quite strict assembler. It's a bit more strict than some of the other ones because my code wasn't working on it, so I've had to make a few tweaks over the places. But you can use SNES 9X or Mesin or even BSNES if you want. And in the case of most emulators, you can just specify the cartridge on the command line, just fire it up and get it started straight away. And that's one of the real advantages of cartridge systems, is they do start straight away, so no messing around with operating systems. If you're going to make mistakes, you want to make them quickly, because then you can fix them quickly. And so that's one of the big advantages of programming cartridge-based systems, even if you do have a bit of a pain getting the getting everything set up because you got no ROM. Because as I say, the firmware and the OS will be a big help in the early days, but will get in your way later on. So it's swings and roundabouts. So there we go. We've had a bit of a play with the Super Nintendo today. If you're interested in Super Nintendo, please take a look around my website and my YouTube channel. I've got a playlist of loads of other Super Nintendo videos, so, you know, have a look at that and see if you want. Of course, as I've said, you can get all of this kind of code and all of the executables and the scripts from my website, so hopefully that'll help you out, get you started a little bit quicker. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Please like and subscribe if you have, but whatever you do, just please enjoy programming the Super Nintendo. Hope you've enjoyed this. Thanks for watching today, and goodbye.